Welcome back to Chipstock Investor.
Podcast edition. Sorry, no video of Kasey's beautiful face and my scraggly beard.
I'm sure they don't mind. We had a really busy week over on our Discord server. We've been talking a lot about various small bets that we're going to be adding to our small cap basket. If you want access to our Discord server, you can check out our Semiconductor Insider membership. Link in the video description below gets you access to everything we're talking about.
You totally want it. Check it out. Look at the link. Okay, let's talk about one of them. Ouster, a LiDAR company. Yes, Ouster. Some of you might know a little bit about Ouster and the company it merged with a couple of years ago, Velodyne. We're going to show you this chart first from our friends at finchat.io to just get a high-level overview of what's going on with Ouster. You can see the big massive bubble that was 2020, 2021, 2022, and everything's been down and mostly stayed down since then. FinChat, fantastic platform. We use it every day to get a handle on companies like this, figure out where they're at, what they're doing, and what their financial profile is.
You can get 15% off any paid membership with the link in our video description or here on the screen. finchat.io/CSI, 15% off any paid plan, finchat.io/CSI. We'll go through a number of slides that show you, if you haven't heard of them, what type of equipment they sell, what industry they're in, where they fit into the semiconductor industry, but maybe you can just give us a quick overview of why we're talking about Ouster today.
It's LiDAR, and we put together the LiDAR chip designer industry stock list. We put a whole list of all the LiDAR companies, all the LiDAR chip designers, manufacturers in there. Ouster is one of them. And it has been on a bit of a run. Aeva, A-E-V-A, which is another LiDAR startup that we'll talk about here momentarily, already has kind of pumped from like $2 a share to $20 a share on very little revenue. And in fact, the reason this came up is I actually talked to one of Aeva's co-founders and CEO about 4 years ago. And I think some of you that have maybe been along with us even before Chipstock Investor was a thing might have a couple shares of Aeva still in your portfolio. We don't. I don't know what happened to our Aeva stock. I suspect it was when we did some sort of rebalancing work in 2022. It was a very small position.
Okay. So we're going to file this one under the fabulous chip designer portion of our semiconductor industry flow. They also have tech equipment and devices. We would probably fit them under there as well. But we're saying fabulous because they do most of their manufacturing is via a third party provider. They do a little bit of sensor manufacturing at their place facility in San Francisco, but
that's probably mostly R&D work.
Mostly. Apparently some manufacturing of sensors.
Let's talk about what LiDAR is though. Right? This is what LiDAR is in a video from Waymo.
How is this different from camera sensing?
I think like Tesla's self-driving system only uses cameras. The car sees what you and I see when driving down the road. LiDAR uses lasers to create a 3D map of the world. And it has a lot of capabilities. If you're interested in thinking about this LiDAR thing and its application in self-driving cars, if you own Google stock, you actually have a LiDAR company in your portfolio. Waymo actually parted ways with a company called Velodyne, a really old business in LiDAR that is now part of Ouster. We'll get to that as well. But they parted ways with Velodyne, I think almost a decade ago now, and they've been building their own LiDAR technology in-house at Waymo. And so part of Google Other Bets, if you own Google stock, you have a lot of LiDAR tech in your portfolio already.
And the benefit to LiDAR versus cameras?
Cameras are tricky because essentially what the AI has to do is it has to categorize what it's seeing from a static image. LiDAR gives the computer a three-dimensional map of the world. There's also a thing called time of flight, TOF, that you'll often see talked about in the LiDAR industry, where you also get some, sometimes it's called four-dimensional LiDAR, where in addition to getting the 3D map of the world, you also get movement of things. inherent in the LiDAR itself, because the laser gets generated by the chip, it reflects off of the object, and then the time that it takes to come back to the chip in red, that's the time of flight, also gives the computer information about the velocity and the direction that these other objects in the world are moving. So it can greatly increase the accuracy of something like a self-driving system.
But the issue has been cost and size.
Cost, right? Size, complexity. Yeah. If you bought a car, like let's say Waymo said, hey, you can buy one of our self-driving cars now. Do you want this thing riding around on your roof? We'll let all of you decide. Would it be cool or not to have a giant LiDAR system on your roof? So these things are making rapid progress. And so let's go back to Aeva. One of the reasons Aeva has pumped this year is because they've been landing some new deals with customers like Airbus One. These are not full-blown commercial contracts yet. Aeva is still mostly a pre-revenue R&D business, but they have some new technology that greatly increases the accuracy of the LiDAR, this FMCW, frequency modulated continuous wave. So another problem with LiDAR is it's complex, and things like glare from the sun might affect the reading or the ability of the car to take accurate readings.
Or the plane in this instance, or
in
this, right?
In case the plane. And so Aeva's technology, FMCW, kind of solves for some of that by not just measuring the time of flight, but also the adjustment in the light when it reflects off of the object. And it can kind of correct for some of these problems.
So this would decrease the wings hitting each other, taxiing, right?
Airbus doesn't become Boeing?
Yeah.
Is that what you're saying?
Yes, that's 100% what I'm saying.
Okay, so back to Ouster, because they don't do this yet. They merged with Velodyne, which is an old LiDAR business, and they have a lot of customers, but not a ton of revenue. And they compete in a bunch of different industries, auto industrial robotics, smart infrastructure, and they use some of these older technologies still, like V-cell, vertical cavity surface emitting lasers, and then also what's called a SPAD, single photon avalanche diodes. As an example, like a V-cell, if you're wondering how a laser is produced by a chip, there's certain type of chips, like in the 3-5 category of semiconductors, like indium phosphide, gallium arsenide. You apply an electric current and they release light when the current is applied. The laser is what generates the laser. So the chip emits the laser, it bounces off the object, and then the SPAD helps collect the signal when it comes back to the LiDAR array. So Ouster has a lot of this older technology, but they're working on getting that updated so that they continue to keep pace with the technological leaders like Aeva. Lots of competition. Again, take a look at the industry stock list we put together on LiDAR plus Google. Just remember Google's on that list as well. Okay. So Kasey, let's address the cost to performance issue with LiDAR. That's one of the reasons it hasn't really taken off yet to date. Moore's law of LiDAR. Now this is marketing material, right? Cost has come down something like 90% in the last decade. Performance keeps increasing. And the products are getting smaller. So all the things you expect from semiconductor technology, the chips get smaller, the performance increases, the cost to manufacture them also decreases. They're going to phase out the Velodyne LiDAR this year and focus on the Ouster next-gen tech that's smaller, comes in a nice, more convenient little box.
This is interesting. For the automotive.
Right.
The DF.
No moving parts. Yeah, maybe you've like been in a Waymo car at this point, or some of these other startups out there. And maybe when the thing pulls up, you see like a spinning device on top of the car. And that's part of the sensor spinning around, you know, reading and mapping the world in 3D. Some of these new LiDAR, there's no more moving parts. So again, smaller box, simpler to manufacture, cheaper cost. So we're seeing the scaling here. And then of course there's software to make that all happen. On the left here, here's another couple of real world solutions of where AI would come in to play in a LiDAR system.
And primarily this is where most of their sales are coming from, this smart infrastructure at this point and the software that goes along with it, figuring out traffic flows or crowd control, all of those types of things with these systems.
or a manufacturing line.
Yeah.
Right. So generative AI getting embedded in here makes the possibility of robotics and real world AI more of a reality. Perhaps companies like Ouster get in on this. More marketing material here, right? It sure looks good.
Right. They say $70 billion market opportunity, and they break this down into robotics, industrial, and then smart infrastructure and automotive being the largest. And as we just mentioned, smart infrastructure is kind of where they're playing primarily now. But automotive, once that DF module is completed, maybe that'll become a bigger portion.
Mm-hmm.
So but let's talk about their goals.
There's a problem, though. Yeah. You got to get rid of the old Velodyne technology that no longer competes very well. So that's one of the goals this year. They're going to phase that out. And while they do that, the newer tech that they're releasing, John Deere, there's another real world application.
Right, farm equipment.
Automating farm equipment. They still expect to get pretty high double digit revenue growth along the way, even as they phase out the old tech, maintain their gross margins, and then work their way towards getting free cash flow positive. Here's the problem, though. They are facing still a pretty sizable hole over the last 12 months, nearly $36 million in negative free cash flow. Let's just ignore GAAP net income for now. This company just needs to reach free cash flow break even. That's like the first step. And if they pull off the revenue growth goal, we're looking at maybe approaching $200 million in revenue by next year. So actually, among LiDAR companies, this is one of the larger ones out there, thanks to the merger with Velodyne back in 2023, early 23.
But how about their balance sheet?
Well, they've got cash to manage the free cash flow burn, no debt. And let's just use the same price to sales, down and dirty valuation cheat, because this is not a profitable business.
Now, Nick, it's come up on a few of our CSI Live discussions about price to sales. What is the usefulness of that metric? And what's the answer other than it being completely useless and meaningless?
Totally useless. Well, no, actually, so here's what we talked about. Well, first of all, price to sales ratio, you can use it for comparative purposes. If you want to compare one similar company to another, you can also look backwards at a company's historical price to sales ratio, like you're looking at here with Ouster. But here's another just a trick, a cheat maybe, because a company like this, a fabless chip designer, we think a good target, a good baseline target for free cash flow margin would be something like 20%. So we have this price to sales ratio, let's call it 4, 5, 6, let's call it mid-single digits price to sales ratio at this point for Ouster. Well, let's pretend that at this current valuation, they are actually running a 20% free cash flow margin. And so here's what that would look like. They'd be today trading for about 30 times price to free cash flow. Is that fair? A fair valuation for a company growing 30 to 50%, price to sales ratio of mid-single digits? Yeah, it could be. They, of course, have to hit that goal, hit that target. They have to execute on all of their plans. Okay, not bad. On a price to sales basis, not as cheap as it could have been earlier this year, but maybe not the peak either. This is one that we're interested enough in just to kind of earmark so that we're paying attention more closely to LiDAR. And I do really believe seeing this pop up more and more among retail investors. So we think investors are going to catch on to this. And especially when everybody is talking about robotaxis, you know, no one's going to be making any money from a robotaxi business anytime soon. Sorry, Tesla, this is a future development, but someone could start making money from selling LiDAR chips.